Good morning. Welcome to Center Point. I see some people that are some hungry people out there. Everybody's in their picnic clothes, ready to eat right afterwards. We're going to have our church picnic, and it's great to have that. I'm so looking forward to it. We have a pinata, we have games, we have food, and we have a great company. I'm so excited that we can have our picnic together. But first, we want to be praising the Lord, and we're going to sing a song today, Church, Take Me Back. That's the first song that we sang when everybody came back. So we had that time where everyone was watching from home, and we all came back, and we sang this song. And I don't know about you, but it was such a blessing to see everyone back. And it's such a blessing to have our church picnic today. So I'm so looking forward to singing, Take Me Back to That Place That Feels Like Home, to the people that I can depend on. And I'm so looking forward to going to the picnic, but also I'm looking forward to worshiping God right now. And we're going to be worshiping God with everything in us. So let's stand and let's say together our call to worship this morning.
Worship is one of the most important things that we will do this morning. And we are to enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. The synagogue service consisted of praise, prayer, scripture reading, and teaching. Let's get our hearts and our heads working together to worship the Lord with songs of praise. Join with me. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith.
Thank you.
take this time to thank God for everything, even our very next breath, which we offer back to Him.
And I
Dear Father, we thank you that you are always for us, Lord. At all times, in weeping and rejoicing, you are for us. You are with us. And if you are with us, who can be against us, Lord? We thank you, Lord, that we could give you praise for the very breath that you give us, Lord. We offer it back to you, Lord. We give you thanks, Lord. We praise you. We thank you that you are with us, Lord. Let us always continually be aware of your presence, Lord. Let us rely on you more and more, Lord. We love you. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. I ask a blessing on everyone here in the rest of the service. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take this time to pray together. If we want to lift up our voice and pray, you'll find the prayer on the inside of your bulletin. And if you'll take that out with me, and let's pray together the congregational prayer. Father, we ask for your blessing upon all of our children. Bless them with your infinite loving kindness and mercy. Watch over them at home, school, and church. Help us as parents, grandparents, and friends to guide them through the maze of life. Keep them safe from all harm and preserve their coming and going every day through every activity. Save them, protect them, and bless them. This we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. And Lord, we do ask a prayer upon all of the children going back to schools, Lord, upon all the teachers, and we have many, Lord, upon everyone here, Lord, who's dealing with different pains and aches and illnesses, Lord. Have your hand upon them. Heal them, Lord. Watch over family members, Lord, that are caring for loved ones that are sick, Lord. We pray for everybody that's dealing with emotional pains, Lord. We all have family members that don't know you, Lord, and there's different things going on in everyone's life, Lord. But we know that you are for us, Lord. And I pray for your hand upon them, Lord, and for your blessing, Lord. I give you thanks, Lord, for what looks like a beautiful weather outside, Lord, that we could celebrate and just enjoy the time together as a community, Lord. And I thank you for this community, Lord. They are a blessing in my life. I know they're a blessing in other people's lives, Lord. And I pray that we will grow and grow and grow together as a family of God, Lord, and that we could do great things for your community. I pray for helping hands, Lord, which is happening tomorrow, Lord, at the packing, Lord. And I pray for both the packing, Lord, and also that we thank you that we could just help in some small way, Lord, to help, to care for people, Lord, like you do, Lord. You care so much for people, Lord, and you care for these children, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that we could be part of that and that you choose to use us, Lord. I thank you for this time and ask your blessing upon it. In Jesus' name, amen. In the inside of your bulletin, if you are a visitor or if you've never filled out a church directory before, we would love to know your name, your children's names, your address, and your email, and your birthday. So if you want to be included on the emails that go out with birthdays, please fill this out. We would love to meet with you, talk with you, email with you, whatever, but we would love to get to know you more and more. So please fill that out if you're a visitor or if you've never filled out one of these before. We have some announcements on the back of your bulletin. If you didn't know, our church picnic is today. So that is right after the service. There's the address on there. It's former, everyone calls it El Air Park. Apparently it's been changed to John Anseline Park, but it's where if you really are from this area, you know that's where the water slides used to be. And that's how you know if you're from Beaver County, because we give directions by, it's where that place used to be. And that's how we all give directions. So I still say, hey, that's where the water slides used to be. So that's where our picnic is this time, and it's great. We're at Pavilion 4. And all the food is free and provided, so come on over. We have a pinata for the kids. We're going to have some great time today. So that's right after the service. And there's directions you'll see right there. You can just follow those. We have the address. You have the directions. So that's right after service. Helping hands. That's tomorrow. That is tomorrow. And just in case, if you don't know what that is, we pack up backpacks filled with school supplies and hygiene products and fill them with backpacks, and then they're delivered to 8 different school districts, and we have 500 backpacks that we're gonna be packing with items. And this is it's fun to do, it's great to see, so everyone's invited. At 5 o'clock, we're gonna start sorting the items, so if you wanna come and help that and help sort them and bring in some items, and 6 o'clock is when we're really gonna start packing the items. So it shouldn't take too long if we have many hands. And I know with the soup kitchen, we've had many hands. So I'm looking forward to tomorrow. And we also want to be praying for all those kids that receive those items. It's just a wonderful ministry, and so we hope that you join us. So that's tomorrow, 5 o'clock for sorting, 6 o'clock for packing all the items, and everyone's invited to that, encouraged to come. Deacons, there'll be a deacon meeting on Thursday, August 26th at 6:45 p.m., and all deacons should attend this meeting, and if you're unable to attend, please see Pastor Stephen. Let him know within the next few days. And at this time, children, you are dismissed. Let's see your bubbles, and everyone else, you can stand and greet one another.
If you please find your seats. I sound like this is hard. If you'll please find your seats. And if you'll please stand for the reading of God's holy word. You know, today is the seventh sermon in this series on the armor of God. And I hope that we have girded ourselves and are girding ourselves with the armor of God, and it's not just that we are reading scripture. And this last one is on the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. All of the other parts of the armor are defensive. This is the only offensive weapon that we have. And hopefully, we will see how important it is. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. There's a reading inside of your bulletin. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with a breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Father, we have studied this passage now for 7 weeks. And I pray, Father, at this last part of the armor, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, is important to us. Help us, Lord, to understand its importance. Help us, Lord, to make it important in our family. Help us, Lord, to make it important that we live by it. Open our ears this morning, Father, for I know that you desire that we not only hear it, but that we take it, eat it, and live it. Thank you, Lord, for letting us come to worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I've always been fascinated with swords. I don't know about you, but there's something that fascinates me about swords. And when I was a little boy, reading about King Arthur and his sword Excalibur, I can remember thinking, wow, it took a very special young man to pull that sword out of the stone, even though it's not real. I know it's not real. But it took a very special man to pull that sword out of the stone. No one else could do it. He had to be special. And then there's King Richard, the Lionheart sword. And again, when I was in eighth grade, I read a book about King Richard, how powerful, how strong he was, the King of England. You know, that's the Robin Hood time period. Then there's Charlemagne's sword, who united most of Europe in the 700s. George Washington's sword, and the sword of William Wallace. Perhaps many of you will remember Braveheart, and the movie was about William Wallace. A visitor came to that museum once and looked at the sword and said, I can't understand how he was able to win so many victories because the sword doesn't look like much. And the curator said, that's because you can't see the arm of the man who wielded it. And that's true. What is important, what is more important? Is the sword important, or is the word important? Because the sword represents the word of God. Well, of course, you need them both. If you have the Bible sitting there, it can't do its work. If you have the person sitting there, he can't pick up the Bible. You need both. You need both a special person that realizes how important the Word of God is and also the Word of God to act together. So if you have your sermon outline and it's in your bulletin, let me encourage you to take it out and take some notes this morning. And as I say every so often, to become a professional note taker, but so that you will at some point this week pull it out again. Take a look at the notes. Get these things in your heart. Reflect on God's word. The sword is a powerful weapon. Back then, they didn't have guns. They didn't have bombs. They didn't have tanks. They didn't have planes. They had swords, bows and arrows, and spears. The sword was used for in-house close fighting. When you got very close to someone, you had to have your sword to repel them and also to attack. It was a short sword. That was short sword. I got it. It was worn on the side, as you can see. It was 2 feet long and 2 inches wide. Something like this, not quite. Now, every so often I bring this out. I think whenever I preach on the Bible, but I thought about wearing it on my side today, but I thought it might scare some people if they saw me walking around with this. This is not quite 2 feet long. So that, yes, who's going to argue with a man with a sword? This is 2 inches short of 2 feet. This part is 2 inches right here. And so the entire sword was 2 inches wide and 2 feet long. It was double-sided so that if that Roman soldier pulled that out, he wouldn't have to worry about which side he's swinging because because both sides were sharp, razor sharp. Who would like to come up here and let me demonstrate how sharp this is? Any volunteers? Who? Ron? I wouldn't do that to you, Ron. This is razor sharp. And their sword was razor sharp. But you know what? You know what is sharper than that double-edged sword? Do you know what is stronger and sharper than that sword? You know, right? The Word of God. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 tells us, "For the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword." And what God is trying to tell us is, back then, that was the weapon that was so important, that was needed, that double-edged sword that they used to attack and defend themselves. But God is saying, I'm telling you that that is not anywhere close to being as sharp as the Word of God. It is alive and active, and that if we take it in, it will change us. I don't know about you, but we all need change. I need changed. Constantly changing. I constantly need changed, and we all need changed. It is sharper than any double-edged sword. You don't want to keep it in your scabbard. If you were a Roman soldier and you were attacking, can you imagine? Can you imagine standing there and the enemy's coming toward you and you keep the sword in its scabbard like that? You'd be cut to pieces. And you don't want to keep the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, on your bookshelf, on your table where it accumulates dust. You don't want to leave it there the entire week and only hear it on Sunday. You don't want to put it in a scabbard. You want that scabbard to be empty because you're using the Word of God every day. And I say this, not to do this, but every day, I pick up the Word of God. My wife and I, every morning, we look at the Bible together. We don't do it Sunday morning because we come here. But every day in the Word, I need it every day, because every day I can be just go a little bit off course, and I need it to bring me back on course. Chuck Swindoll, that great man of God that has written so many books and helped so many people, great pastor, teacher, he has said, if I could have only one wish for God's people, it would be that we would realize once for all that his book has the answers. The Bible has the answers. He goes on, in a world of relativism, and we're there, aren't we? We are living at a time of relativism, which means you have your truth, your friends have their truth, all kind of different beliefs, whether it's true or not. Hey, I'm happy for you that you believe in God. Truth is relative today. But in the world of relativism, the Bible talks in terms of right and wrong, good and bad, yes and no, true and false. In a world where we're encouraged to do it if it feels good, the Bible addresses that which is sinful and holy. Don't hear that word too often today, sinful. It provides the kind of solid foundation you and I need. And of course, after that we go, amen. Yes, we do need that every day, every single day. Now, two Greek words, logos and rhema, is the word of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The sword is the Word of God. The word word could possibly, well, not possibly, it's one of those two words. And we've all heard both of those words, I'm sure, in our Christian walk at some point. Logos. It's the total Bible. It's the total Word of God. If you read the Gospel of John, Jesus is the living word, the Logos. He's the living word, total word, the living word of God. Rhema is a specific word or portion of God's word, a timely word applied to a specific situation. That is the word that's used in our verse here this morning. That's the word, rhema, rhema, a specific word. In other words, it's not the whole Bible that's used here. It is when you have a situation, if you have a problem, you may not pull out the whole Bible, but maybe a verse comes to your mind and you say it or you think it. Or you have a situation going on in your family and you know where this, you look in the Bible. Yes, it's that verse that covers it. That's rhema. You receive a rhema. It's a specific word, a specific scripture verse that you pull out, that you say, that you speak out. If you remember, Jesus was tempted by the devil. In fact, Scripture tells us he was driven into the desert. He was driven into the desert where Satan tempted him three times, three separate times. And it's very interesting. I should preach a sermon just on that. Very interesting. Let me just kind of bring it down a little bit, not go into great detail. Satan tried to get Jesus to act independently of God, the first temptation. Try to get him to act independently of God. If you are the Son of God, he says. But he wanted Jesus to act independently. He wants us to do the same thing. He wants you to do the same thing. He wants you to think, you know what, I know the Bible says this, but hey, if I don't do this, what's going to, I have to do this. And he wants us to stray. He wants us to go our own way, just like he wanted Jesus. Jesus said Scripture and repelled Satan with the word of God, with a rhema. The second temptation, Satan tried to get Jesus to compromise Scripture. And he wants you to do that constantly. He wants you to compromise the Word of God. He wants you to compromise your faith. He wants you to say, yes, again, I know, but this is important too. And you kind of push God aside and you do what you feel is important because that's what the world is doing. And you go in line with the world. Because you don't want to do something different. You're going to think you're going to miss out on something. Your family's going to miss out on something. It's compromising the Word of God. Three, the third temptation, Satan tempted Jesus with a spiritual shortcut. If you remember that, he took him up to a high. If you will bow down and worship me, I will give you all of this. How tempting. If you will bow down and worship me, I will give you spiritual shortcuts. There are no such things. There are no such things as spiritual shortcuts in life. When I was an undergraduate in college at Duquesne, I used to hate to study late at night. I know that many college students did. I used to call it concentrated studying, where I would get up very early in the morning and I would study. And thinking that was, and it kind of worked for a while, but there are no such things as shortcuts. You have to put the time in. And if you want your family to be standing at with God, you have to put the time in with them, with God. Jesus said this, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every rhema that proceeds from the mouth of God. That's one of the things that he replied to Satan. Man does not live by bread alone. How many times a day do we eat? My goodness, many times. How many desserts in between? If I counted yesterday, a lot. A lot. Man shall not live by bread alone. It's not about just eating. It's not just about living our life. Man does not live It's not, our life is not just about eating and having fun and all of this, although that's great. But he wants us to be living by the word of God, the rhema that proceeds from the mouth of God. We could stop right here and say, let's take this home and let's make this part of our life, that we want the word of God to be so important to us that every time I eat something, how about this? Every time you eat some food, think, okay, I have to also take a look at Scripture. When you eat lunch, you should have a little devotional or something there. When you're alone, read God's word. Bring your mind back in the focus where it needs to be. Are you familiar with R.C. Sproul? I hope you are. I know many of you are. R.C. Sproul, one of the great theologians of the 20th century. He's now in glory with God. And he has written so many books. One of the great teachers of the 20th century. Well, his ministry is called Ligonier Ministries. They still function. But take a look at some of these statistics that they came up with. Only 50% of American Christians can name the four Gospels. Now, not Americans, 50% of American Christians can name the four Gospels. I don't know about you, but I find that shocking. It makes me wonder what's going to happen to Christianity down the road. 51% of evangelical Christians agree that God accepts the worship of all religions. 51% of evangelical Christians, those who hold the Word of God, to be the Word of God, those typically who may be more serious for God, agree that God accepts the worship of all religions. You know what that is, don't you? That's the modern version of the Arian heresy back in the early church. The modern version of the Arian heresy that was very difficult to stamp out in the early church. 78% of evangelical Christians agree that Jesus is the first and greatest being created by God. Scary. 53% of Christian millennials, that's age 25 to 40, agree that the Bible contains helpful accounts of ancient myths, but is not literally true. Frightening. Frightening statistics. Frightening. Some of you may have been in the Korean War. I certainly was not. You may think I'm old enough to be. 1950 to 1953 was the Korean War. There was a unit called Baker Company. They got separated from their regiment in one of the battles. No word was heard from them for a number of hours. And then finally, radio contact was made. And they said, the enemy is to the east of us. The enemy is to the west of us. The enemy is to the north of us. And the enemy is to the south of us. And then that was it for a while. And then they came back and they said, but we will not let the enemy escape this time. At times we may be surrounded, and we feel like we're surrounded by life's issues and problems. Don't forget the armor of God. Don't forget the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And I know that we get awfully worried when a crisis comes upon us. That's when we need to call one of our friends, one of our Christian people here. Can you pray with me? Give a scripture verse. Why is the Bible important? We know why the Bible is important, but let me just emphasize again, because it is possible that we keep the sword in the scabbard. And I want to impress upon you, we don't want to get into that very bad habit. It is God's word to us. In other words, it is God's word. If I told you, and if it were true, and we know it's not, and I'm not saying this is going to happen, and if it were true, Jesus has come back to earth, and he wants to meet with us tonight and speak to us. Every single one of us would be here if we thought that were true. If we thought that were true, every one of us would be here. But he's given us his word. And yet, the statistics that tell us how many Christians do not read it are staggering, which explains some of the information that I said earlier. It is God's word to us. It is his word. It is God's word. Verse 17, the sword of the Spirit, which is the rhema of God. Which is the rhema of God. And then there's this one, 2 Timothy 3:16, which we know, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. It is all God-breathed, and it's useful for all of those things, teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And the Greek word for God-breathed is theopneustos. Theopneustos. And it's made up of two words, theos, God, neo-breathe, and you put it together, and you have God-breathed. It comes from God. God's word comes from God. Now, I'm going to get a little technical right now, and I'm going to get a little theological, and maybe more so than maybe I typically might, although I try to do that every week to some degree. The Bible has these characteristics, and if the Word of God is important to us, and I hope it is, we should know some of these things. It's inerrant. It is inerrant. You know what that means? It means it is free from error in all that it affirms. Do you believe that? Oh, my goodness. Yes. I believe that. You believe that? Oh, yeah. I hope you believe that. It is inspired. It is inspired, which means God supernaturally directed the writers so that what was written was what God wanted written. He used their personalities. And in fact, I love the way that works out because, and I've said this before, in the Gospel of John, you will see the word witness or some form of it probably at somewhere around 54 times in the first five chapters. He likes to use also the word light a number of times. He uses their personalities, but it is what God wants to be written. It is infallible. It is infallible. The Word of God is infallible, which means it is unfailing in its purpose. It's unfailing in its purpose. It is sufficient, which means it contains all that is needed for Christian living. It contains all that is needed for living the Christian life. If we want to live the Christian life the way that I know we want to, but I think sometimes other things get in the way too many times, it is sufficient. And then last, it is authoritative. All theological explanations of Scripture, which means it has all the truths necessary for right beliefs. And today, people have so many beliefs that sometimes I feel this, I feel that. Well, it's their feelings rather than what God has to say. And we need to get rid of our opinions, we need to get rid of our feelings, and we need to just take God's word and take it in and get it here and get it here. Now, let me give you 20 reasons why you should read the Bible. Let me give you 20 reasons why the Bible is important. Let me give you 20 reasons why you should get the Bible and read it every day with your family or with your friend or with your date or with your wife or by yourself. 20 reasons, 20 good reasons. One, it's essential for knowing God. It is essential for knowing God. It is so important. By the way, these people are leaving. They're not mad at me. They're all going to prepare for you for the picnic. Look, they're all leaving. I think they're mad at Bob this morning. go and take care of the picnic for you, for me. It is essential for knowing God. I love this passage in Philippians where Paul says, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. He knew Christ, and he knew him as his Savior, but he wanted to know him more and more and more. And that should be the same truth for us, that we should desire to know him better and better and know him more and more. Two, it is God's guide for finding direction in life. You ever wonder, I wonder what direction I should go? And I have found many times that we Christians usually rely, we won't say this, but it's our impressions. It's our impressions rather than God's guide. What does he have to really say about this? What does he really say about these things? Third, it is God's guide for finding Jesus. And in finding Jesus, finding salvation. Apart from the word of God and hearing it, I don't know how someone can come to Christ unless someone is speaking the word of God to them. Four, it gives us a history of the Christian faith. Wow. If you want to learn about the Christian faith, read the book of Acts. That's a short history. It's a short history of the Christian faith, basically telling us how Christianity spread. Not all completely, but at that time in the early church. Five, it's God's guide for living life. Many people, I think, kind of float along in life. And they, you know, you grow up, you get married, or you don't get married, and you get a job, and you kind of just float along with the rest of culture. And culture is going this way, and kind of float along with it. God has a guide for telling us how we should be living our lives. Six, it is God's guide for discovering your purpose in life. Why are you here? Why are you here? And of course, we as parents, we love our children. We do. But if that is the only reason and purpose why we're here, think of the generations. Then their children grow up, and that's their children. But what is your purpose besides your children? God didn't have you born just to have children. He has a purpose for his kingdom, for you. He has a reason that you were created at this time. When I came to Christ, Stacy and I were doing quite well financially. You're not going to like this one. But during that time, we cut our salary in half 3 times because I felt God calling me into the ministry. And I stopped this, and I quit that, and I stopped doing this, quit that, and gave all my time. I'm not telling you to do that. What I am telling you is that when I came to Christ, I discovered why I was here. And I got off of that wave where the wave was just kind of moving along, and I had a good job, and I was doing this, and I had all kinds of activities. And they're fine, these activities. I discovered why I was here. It gave me purpose in life. I have a purpose. Seven, it is God's guide to nourish your soul. And we need nourished. We need nourished. Every day we need nourished. Eight, it is God's guide for spiritual growth. Are you growing? I hope you're growing. Every Sunday we have an opportunity to grow. My job is to teach God's word. But as I said so many times, truth only positions you to change. It doesn't change you. It only positions you to change. You must take it in and make adjustments in your life. Nine, God's guide. It's God's guide to find out what's important in life. What really is important? Just like that old movie, What's It All About, Alfie? What's life all about? I like to have fun, but when I go to stand before God, he's not going to say, well, how much fun did you have down there? Tell me about all the times you had fun. I want to hear about all the fun you had. He wants us to have fun, but he doesn't want that to be what life is all about. We're going to be in trouble if that's what all we have to say. 10, God's guide. It's God's guide for teaching what is right and what is wrong. And in teaching us what is right and what is wrong, teaching our children how they should live also. When our children are young, we're not their friends, we're their parents. We want to be their parents. We become friends when they grow up a little bit. 11, it's God's guide to keep you faithful to God. And there are so many temptations today in this world pulling us and tugging us. It's so hard to be faithful. It is God's guide to keep us faithful. 12, it's God's guide for living life victoriously in Christ. Haven't you discovered how tough it is to live today? So many things going on, so many things going wrong. And that you read Rhema from God and you get encouraged. Or someone gives us a Rhema. 13, it's God's guide for producing lasting fruit. And while we're here, one of our functions is we need to be producing fruit for God. You will know them by their fruit, Scripture says. You will know them by their fruit. How's our fruit? Are we bearing fruit for God? 14, it's God's guide for discovering truth. Not my truth. Not a denominational truth. God's truth. We need to be in His Word and find out. When I was a very, very young Christian, a pastor from a certain church told me that Jesus was the Son of God, but was not God. That didn't sound right. It didn't feel right. But I went home. I thought, you know, maybe I've been believing something else. And I found in Scripture that indeed He is God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And in the Greek, that means in the beginning was the Word, was continually with God, and the Word was continually God. That's what the Greek says. 15, it's God's guide for overcoming sin and temptation. And I don't know about you, but whenever I do something, I kind of go, you dummy. You dummy. And we want to be overcomers. 16, it's God's guide for finding encouragement. And we need encouragement. And God's Word gives us encouragement constantly. 17, it's God's guide for dating. That's just one of the verses there. That tells us who we should date. It tells us who we should be dating. 17, it's God's guide for marriage. And there are a number of passages in Scripture. One of the good ones, of course, Ephesians chapter 5, but there are many. 19, it's God's guide for parenting. And there are many, many Scriptures. I have some of them up. You can see some of them. It tells us how we should parent our children. And one of the ways it tells us that we should be giving them the Word of God constantly, constantly. 20, the Bible is a lamp. The Bible is a lamp. Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Tom, can you turn off all the lights for a moment? I mean all the lights. All the lights. Every light. Yes. Hello. Now, if the camera probably can't see me, but thy word is a lamp unto my feet. And I don't know about you, but I don't care how dark it is, I'm not going to fall down. And if I were to go down these steps, I would make it down. But you may not. Thank you, Tom. You can put them all back on and get those back on also. I can remember once when I was in college, I belonged to a group. I may have said this once. I belonged to a group that we put on many, many different concerts. And one day, where we were, I can't even remember, Wisconsin or someplace, and we were doing a barbershop number, and I was the second person in line. And it was so dark, we couldn't see anything. And I held on to the person's vest in front of me, and the next thing I heard was, doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. He fell off the stage. And nothing we could do. We had to go on without him. He kind of crawled back up, but thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. In this dark world that we live in, and I know you know here that it is not getting better out there. In this dark time that we need a light to guide us so that we don't go off course. How easy is it for us to go off course? Very easy. We can easily follow the course of the world because it will want to lead us off course. And the difficult thing is to stay on. Now, did you watch the Steelers last night? I did. And I don't get a lot of time off, but I like to watch a game. And that's not a Steelers playbook. I couldn't find a real one. But let's say that that is. Every rookie and every player that came to camp received the Steelers playbook, especially because they got a new offensive coordinator this year. And they're all expected to take this playbook home and to learn the plays. Now, can you imagine what would happen if Pat Freiermuth, and in case you don't know, he's a rookie tight end. In case you don't, he caught 2 touchdowns last night. But let's just say that he took the playbook and read it through once. Would you expect him to go out and play a game? If you had enough, we have all new offensive linemen. What if, well, yeah, I kind of casually read it. I didn't read it every day, the playbook. I just kind of take a look at it every so often. You would have one guard going this way, one guard going this way, another one going, and they would get hammered. What am I saying? Do you realize how important it is, the Word of God, for us? And how easy it is for us to go off in strange directions, just like it would be for a football team. If it's important for a football team to play a game, just to play a game, can you imagine how important it is in life to live a life that God has called us to? GPS. Went to Pittsburgh Friday, and we were going to a certain place, and typically I've been there a number of times before, but we went in a different direction. So I used the GPS. And if it had not been for the GPS, I may have gotten a little lost because it was taking me a different way than which I was used to. We can't live without a GPS today, it seems. We really need a GPS to get around. You know what's more important than GPS? God's Word. It's a perfect GPS for us in our life. Back then, they had compasses. We've progressed greatly. We have GPSs now. But God's compass is the Bible to direct us. Would you agree? Would you agree that the world today has lost its moral compass? Yes. The world today has lost its moral compass. And what most of us do, I think most of us kind of go, that's the world. We think as long as it's not touching us. But I need to tell you that your children are interacting with strange teachings today that they hear and think and put in there, and maybe they might, but when they leave your home and they're old enough, they then go off. And it's our job as parents to make sure, more than anything else, that they are where they need to be. Look at this, a survey of 2,930 Christians. Now, these are Christians. Survey of not 10, not 20, 2,930 Christians. How often do I read the Bible? 19%. Only 19% read it every day. 26% read it a few times a week. 14% once a week. 22% at least once a month. And 18% hardly ever. And again, why are you here? You're not here by accident. God has created every one of us here for a purpose, for right now, for be using and to serve him in his kingdom. Those are scary, just like everything else I've shared with you. You know, there are three types of Bible readers. Let me share the three types of Bible readers. There's the castor oil type. This kind is, to them, the word is bitter. Boy, that God, I don't know. Oh, the God of the Old Testament, I don't like him. I like the God of the New Testament. Guess what? It's the same God. Then there is the shredded wheat type that reads Scripture. They realize the Bible is good, and it may be nourishing, but it's very dry. Very dry. When I was looking and searching for God with all of my heart, when I was in college, searching for God with all of my heart, I would try reading Genesis, and I got to put it aside. Then I would go to Matthew, put it aside. I did that probably 3 or 4 times. Why? Because I didn't realize just how valuable and what it meant. Here's a third type, the hot fudge sundae type. They can't get enough. Boy, and I love ice cream too. How many people like ice cream? A lot. Yes. I bet I could eat more ice cream than any of you. Mike says, no way. I piled a big dish up yesterday, and then I went back for more. I mean, there was the dish, and it was piled up like this. Can you top that, Mike? I hope all of us here are the hot fudge sundae types. Not the castor oil or the shredded wheat type. There's nothing wrong with shredded wheat, but I'm talking about now, you know, applying it to reading Scripture. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. God wants us not to remain babies while we're here. He wants us to grow up so that we grow up, we can be useful for him. And again, you may squeeze into heaven, but he's not going to ask you, so how much fun did you have down there now? Tell me again. I had a lot. I also worked too. You know, I worked. You know, I had to raise my family, and you know, that work was hard. So that you may grow up in your salvation. Jedediah Smith, Joseph Walker. Two mountain men, real guys. Real guys who lived in the 1800s. Jedediah Smith, Joseph Walker. Both of them, oh, by the way, Jedediah Smith, at one time, still a record today of mountain men, 668 beaver pelts. No one has ever gotten more beaver pelts than Jedediah Smith. They both decided to search for a way to get to California because there was no trail yet to get there. And so Jedediah Smith took off with a number of men. After 3 years, 28 of the men he had with him died, and he came back. He failed. Joseph Walker took 40 men with him and told them to bring with him 60 pounds of beef jerky. Some of you would say, oh boy, that's good. 60 pounds of beef jerky. And along the way, he consulted with Indians, and he took down notes, and he wrote down directions. What he did, he came back, paved the way for the California Trail, if you're familiar with that. the work he did. Two men, both equally gifted in what they did. The difference, one planned and prepared. One planned and prepared. And of course, applying it spiritually, I'm not talking about planning for your career, planning for, I want to belong to the sports league. Those are fun things. Those are nice. But I'm talking about planning for eternity, planning for your children's eternity, planning and prepared. There's a difference. Both men were gifted. Both men kind of knew, but one of them planned and prepared, and the other one did not. And it makes a difference. It makes a difference. And I want to tell you, and I want to urge you, and I say this every so often, that please have a devotional time with your spouse or with your friend every day, with your family. If you have children, every day, don't miss. You won't regret it. And when they're little, their eyes may dart this way and that way. Ours did when they were little. But you don't read gobs of it. Just read a little bit, 3 or 4, 5, 6, 7 verses. You don't have to be an expert. You know what God's saying here? Then you pray every day. Ours was every day after dinner. And then everybody would kind of go their own way. Every day. Don't miss. Do it. It works. About 3 months ago, I had us read before the service began, I think it was, some affirmations about Scripture. I'm going to ask you to do that in closing today. Affirmations about the Word of God. Read it out loud with me. We affirm that the Holy Scriptures are the inspired, inerrant, infallible, and the authoritative Word of God given by divine inspiration through the Holy Spirit, through human writers as designated by God. We affirm that the Holy Scriptures are the sole authority for the church and therefore are the final authority for all doctrine and practice. We affirm that the Holy Scriptures are to be studied, believed, and obeyed as God's holy word and command. It is meant to be our guide as we journey in this life so that we will stay on course. Amen. Amen. Musicians.
We need the solid rock. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ's righteousness. Dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock, stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground
matter how solid the ground you may be walking on may feel, if the Word of God is not preeminent in your life, it is shaky. It is scary, whether you think it is or not, it is, because that means you're being pulled and tugged. I pray that all of us realize how important it is. Now, I will not be greeting you this morning because we're all going to start our engines. Start your engines. And no racing, please, but make your way to the picnic area. God bless you today. Father, we give you thanks that we could come and worship with you and hear God's word. I pray, Father, that all the food we eat will not put on even 1 pound for us. Bless us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. We will see you there.